tiny in all that air. The Philip Larkin Society Podcast.
Hello and welcome to Tiny in All That Air, the Philip Larkin Society podcast. My name is Lynn Lockwood. My guest today is writer and railway historian Greg Morse, and this is the second of our two podcasts with a John Betjeman focus. And I hope you enjoy our discussion as we explore Betjeman and Larkin's relationship with the media, 20th century architecture, cultural history, and of course lots of poetry, both Larkin and Betjeman's.
Larkin and Betjeman would make of all of this technology, but I suppose they would have changed with it.
Yeah, I think Betjeman would have had his podcast already. He'd have certainly been on other people's podcasts, reminiscing about the old BBC and how lovely it was when he just had four channels.
Yes, yeah, there would have been the two sides. He probably would have done a podcast about that, in fact, and covered both things in the one.
Really, I guess I was just going to ask you to talk a bit about how you got interested in Betjeman, really, to start off with, and Larkin.
I mean, essentially, well, Betjeman came first for me, and they both arrived at the same sort of time as I was studying my A-levels at the end of the 80s. We had a little anthology in the A-level English Lit class, and a few Betjeman poems and a few Larkin poems were in there. And I suppose I was gripped at that point by executive. You know, I am a young executive, loves the minor cleaner, et cetera, amused by the reference to the firm's Cortina, because you could still see Cortinas on the road.
Yeah.
In 88, 89 sort of time. So I did an exam answer on him, but it wasn't really until the 10th anniversary of Betjeman's death in 94 that I really became more obsessively interested, I suppose.
Yeah.
I was staying with a mate of mine in Bangor, and my mum had watched an episode of Time with Betjeman, because they were running an awful lot of Betjeman's TV shows at that time to mark the anniversary. And I found her, and she happened to say, "Oh, you know, you might like this. Give it a try next Saturday," or whatever it was, and I did, and she was absolutely right. And so I was sucked in, really, by Betjeman the broadcaster first, I guess. And then they reran a lot more programmes, and I seemed to enjoy all of them. And then it clearly became time to invest in the books and revisit the poetry.
Yeah.
And so that's sort of how it started. I guess that the literati certainly of the 50s, 60s, and I'm counting Waugh in that, would be very disparaging of the fact that that somebody came to Betjeman not through his verse in the later 20th century, but through his TV. But in a way, I think that's where some of Betjeman's finest prose poem work comes, in his commentaries.
Yeah, when you can match up the images and his voice and his presence, it does work really, really well, doesn't it? The other day I watched the short monitor Betjeman programme where he's walking around London looking at sort of bomb-damaged London in the 1950s. I don't know if you've seen that one.
It brings it to life, doesn't it?
Yeah, he's looking at the railways and all these ruined spaces, which now are probably really highly valuable, you know, property areas. And he does have a really engaging TV personality, when the idea of being a TV personality was quite new. So he sort of grasped that new way of communicating, didn't he?
He did, and with both hands, arguably. I mean, he was one of the earliest broadcasters. I think his career stretches all the way back to the earliest days of Broadcasting House. A toe in the water, certainly. But you get that impression also in the monitor show that he did with Larkin. When he reads Church Going, as Larkin is walking round the church, I think. interestingly, Larkin later commented, as I'm sure you and the members will know very well, that the programme perhaps should be retitled to Hull with John Betjeman, because Betjeman does take over a bit. But as you rightly say, Betjeman was the star at the time. Older as well, of course, and selling more poetry, arguably, than anybody since Tennyson at that point.
And he was a sort of safe pair of hands for Larkin, wasn't he?
Yeah, I mean, he's clearly a fan, but the way he reads Church Going, I think, really imbues it with the great sensitivity and understanding, when you could argue that it was almost the antithesis of the way Betjeman would visit a church. Because, I mean, that's a great link between the two men. They both had this interest in visiting churches. But although Betjeman occasionally suffered almost a Victorian inner faith and doubt debate, he affirmed his faith whilst being afraid that it was untrue, the Christmas story was untrue. Mm. Nevertheless, when he got into a church, particularly if it was a Ninian Comper one, perhaps, he knew what it was about and why it was there. Whereas Larkin, I often wondered if Larkin was referring to Betjeman in that poem. Betjeman is the person who would probably know if a church was cleaned or restored, for example.
I find it really poignant in that bit where Larkin's walking around the church, and when he walks out and says, you know, I signed a book, donate an Irish sixpence, reflect the place was not worth stopping for. And to hear Betjeman say that line is really moving, because, as you say, I think everyone was aware of Betjeman's very different attitude towards churches and his, you know, Anglicism and everything else. So it's lovely to hear him read that line. It's like that inclusivity you can get in poetry.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And yet even Larkin, and yet stop, I did. In fact, I often do. Still the church had a power to reel him in the first place. And yet the great prescience that then follows, which again you have Betjeman reading, as you rightly say, of what is going to happen to churches as time goes on, at a time when Anglican church attendance was falling, and Betjeman was well aware of that and covers it in a Lincolnshire church himself. It is poignant on even another level still, I think. Betjeman's sort of thespian acting capabilities obviously helped him an awful lot in doing these things. Even Waugh said that he'd read some novel, I forget which, regrettably, on the radio, probably at a similar sort of time, and Waugh commented that Betjeman had somehow managed to succeed in breathing new life into those old bones, as he put it. He just had a mellifluous sort of voice. We don't tend to get that on television so much anymore. Perhaps people like Stephen Mangan get close to that ability to narrate and make you want to listen to them. But Betjeman was certainly one of those people.
He did. He had a really beautiful voice. And there's something so nostalgic about his voice, because he still has some of those older sort of Queen's English inflections, doesn't he? That he kind of took on probably when he went to Oxford and went into that kind of upper circle of the kind of aristocracy. But I think, you know, it's very English and very comforting, like Kenneth Williams. And I think today someone like Stephen Fry, for example, has that voice that's sort of very engaging. I find actually, you know, Claire Balding, the sports commentator, I'm not a fan of sports, but when I hear her voice on the radio, I find that, you know, just very engaging.
Yeah, I agree. These people, all of these people capture the ear, don't they? And retain it for as long as they are speaking, I think.
Yeah, Stephen Fry's got a good sideline in reading podcasts for people to listen to in the night, hasn't he, at the moment? If you can't sleep, if you're suffering anxiety attacks like we all are. Stephen Fry apparently is one of the people you go to. But I think Betjeman would be quite good for that, actually.
Samuel West can do it as well. Yeah. Currently, of course, known to many, I guess, it's Siegfried in the new All Creatures Great and Small. I must stop calling it All Creatures Grunt and Smell, which is an all too honest joke, but it always comes to mind. But oddly, Samuel West did do some Betjeman readings for a documentary many, many years ago, particularly affecting in Death in Leamington. So again, that kind of actorly approach that Betjeman himself had, a kind of interesting parallel there.
Is Samuel West does the... is it like a podcast he does, a poetry reading Online poetry readings.
I believe, yes, he's been doing that since the lockdown, I believe. Yeah. Very, very good, very engaging it is too.
Yeah.
You find a lot of old treasures by these means, I think.
I think poetry has been a great consolation for people during lockdown, actually, from what I can hear anyway. And I know there's a lot of interest in Larkin as a poet of kind of social isolation and a poet of kind of uncertainty. And I think he's really brought a lot to the sort of national language during lockdown. So it's really interesting. So I know we're talking about the Monitor documentary that just featured Betjeman walking around London. And obviously he was talking about the... You'll know this. It's not Aldgate, is it? The station that had the steam trains and the diesels running.
Oh, it might be Aldersgate Street. That was a favourite of his. Latter-day Barbican station.
Oh, is it? Oh, right.
Aldersgate Street used to have a fine tea shop where Betjeman used to like to go to have tea, and had an overall roof that was bombed during the war. And it became a bit of a shadow of its... former self.
Oh, yes, yeah. He shows that in the documentary, I think. You see a little glimpse of where the tea shop was. And so you had the steam train on one side and you had the diesel train on the other side. And obviously for Betjeman, that he was using that as a kind of symbol of that change in our national landscape from steam to diesel.
Absolutely, yes.
In the sort of... And I know I think that's a really significant moment, you know, for Betjeman and Larkin and for the national consciousness, really.
Yeah, he spoke quite often about the dreaded Dr. Beeching, who of course wasn't a terrible fellow as he was painted in the media at the time, but he becomes a metaphor. I wonder what he's a doctor of, Betjeman once said at a conference, presumably not a doctor of heart, because there was that feeling that the heart of the country was being torn out at
the
time.
Yeah.
And of course the modernisation that wasn't started by Beeching, but certainly was sped up by Beeching, really did make that shift from steam to diesel in the 1960s faster than I think it had originally been intended.
Yeah.
And when things change like that, and I think it's true of buildings, skylines that one has always known, even the painting of a house frontage, which is more common now and certainly wouldn't have occurred back then, Betjeman often referred to sort of tearing away at the soul. These things are embedded in us. And when they change, it isn't always a case of change for the good. Many people lament what is gone because it's part of them that has gone, part of the memory that's been taken away. And I think steam to diesel is part of that. And Betjeman did a very good British Transport film short called Railways Forever, which spoke exactly of these sorts of things. You know, the other villain for Betjeman was the developer's lorry, of course.
Yeah.
And that parallel is drawn in that film. And, of course, in his little poem about Bath being carted off by developer's lorry. He did once say that post-war urban redevelopment caused more damage to Britain's landscape than German bombing ever could have done, which sounds an extraordinary thing to say in from our current standpoint. I mean, we sort of fetishise World War II still a bit, and I think that sounds almost insulting. But of course, if you were there at the time, you see the world changing from the one you knew, the one you grew up in, to a potholed world. After the war, if you watch the Ealing comedy, not much comedy at the start of this, but Passport to Pimlico.
Oh, yeah.
Stanley Holloway's character falls into a crater, a bomb crater, near the start of the film, and it's seen as a laugh and a bit of a jape, and he's pulled out of it, I think. I haven't seen the film for a while, by children and, you know, neighbours and what have you. But that is actually a scar of war. But then to have it have a new one of the new glass cliffs, white cliffs, I think he calls them. He would call them glass cliffs now, of course, Betjeman, its place, looking like nothing on earth that had gone hitherto. It's a very rapid change. And I think rapid change alarms people.
Mm.
That's probably part and parcel of why poets like Larkin and Betjeman remain important, because they do capture these pockets of time, Larkin's Whitsun and weddings, his steam train journey,
mm.
at a time when that was one's principal means of getting about the country.
Yeah, yeah.
For lots and lots of people. He captured it so well, the rhythm so well. Betjeman recanted it, allowed so frequently because of that, even his daughter, candidate Lysett Green, got to know it off by heart just by listening to her dad reading it aloud. Such was that railway-like rhythm of the poem, despite what else it might be about. And my favourite line is probably the reference to frail travelling coincidence.
Yeah.
Because that is exactly what life is. Life yeah. is an enormous Venn diagram, and some of us intersect, and many of our lives don't intersect, despite what adults to the music of time might make it look like.
Yeah.
That sequence says more about Pole himself than what most people's lives are really like. To most of us, life is a frail travelling coincidence.
Yeah, that's the line that Grayson Perry used for his keynote lecture for the Larkin Society a couple of years ago. And I think he would very much agree with what you were saying about how life is that fragile series of connections. Frail's an amazing word to pick, isn't it?
It is. Another startling image for me is the hothouse flashed uniquely. I think that's absolutely wonderful. Because, working as I do in London, or did,
yeah.
before lockdown, travelling to London by train, even in the modern era, even without the ability to smell beyond what's within my hermetically sealed carriage, that experience of going by these different landmarks, it's still relevant to today. Larkin yeah. really does capture it. I can completely see why Betjeman was so taken with that poem.
Yeah, it's just an astonishing poem. And whenever I go to London, which obviously hasn't been for a while now, unfortunately, I love to go and see the plaque at King's Cross. And they have the final lines that matches up with the first line at the statue in Hull.
Oh, yes.
And,
yes.
Somewhere becoming rain. It's just such a beautiful ending that, it's not an ending. It's something continuing.
Yes, it's very vivid, isn't it? In a way that perhaps only poetry can be in writing. Grayson Perry can do it, and all other artists can do it visually. But in writing, it's sometimes only poetry that can capture that image successfully, I think.
Yeah.
Because I think what's interesting about the use of the railway in the Whitsun weddings, it is sort of a twofold thing, really. As we were just saying, train travel over great distance or any distance, really, was the principal option for most people. At the time of the poems, well, at the time of the poem's publication, as well as the time it was written,
yeah,
really, it was the mid-60s, I think, when things started to turn and talk at British Rail, as it had then become, began to turn to how can we make trains even faster to try to persuade people to use us over long distance again, because there were competition from domestic airlines by this time. But earlier than that, if you wanted to go a distance, it had to be by default by train. So it captures that moment, but also it's also allegorical, because life is a journey, until one gets to the terminus, so to speak. And I think because the poem straddles that change that we were talking about from steam to diesel, old to new, new to newer still, there is some thinking to be done, I think, about what else you might extract from the poem in above and beyond simply, well, there's nothing simple about any poem, is there, really? But above and beyond a sketch of common experience, the search for the truth, as Betjeman said of Larkin, about the collection, the Whitsun weddings, for example. And that is something I would like to look into. as I say, Larkin came to me much later than Betjeman. My first book was on Betjeman. It was effectively my thesis tweaked around a bit.
Okay, yeah.
The older I've got, though, the more attractive Larkin's writing has got, I think, in my mind, has come to me, because I like the cynicism. Betjeman's very good at seeing good, even, I think, in the 30s when he was becoming a professional writer, because I suppose of some of the company he was keeping and some of his aspirations, could be quite snobbish in his writing, even when talking about the business of writing. And this will bring us back to Monitor, I guess, in a minute, unless I go off on one again. He wrote that he because he was churning out architectural articles one after the other to fill this magazine, the Architectural Review.
Yeah,
I've written the word architecture more times than people know how to spell it correctly. I think he wrote, which is funny, but also very snobbish thing
to
say.
Yeah,
when Betjeman met a real person, though, he seemed to see the positives and see the good. I mean, I think he'd had a pop at the town hall of Leeds in that same magazine. But when he went to Leeds in 1933, I think it was, he actually met some people from Leeds who put their view across, and it changed his mind. When Betjeman could see a person and engage with, very good at engaging with people, he was able to see their point of view much more readily. Now, interestingly, in the Monitor programme, which I'll continue to call To Hull with John Betjeman, in deference to Larkin's view, they both discuss this difference in their working lives that they had. Larkin had a real job, as it were, being the librarian at the University of Hull. And so he was subject to the slings and arrows of outrageous office politics, as many before and since will have been, of course. And you know, he talks, doesn't he, about binding up the minutes.
Yeah.
That makes a rather neat little joke about them being very good minutes, but it being somewhat limited artistically. but he had that other life where he would go to it and come back, whereas Betjeman was a writer all the time. Whether he was churning out hack work, as he thought of it himself sometimes, for a newspaper or Time and Tide or something like that. Nevertheless, I think that writing life gave Betjeman more opportunities to see those quote-unquote real people, like met at Leeds in 1933. So I think that's quite an interesting parallel to draw, but the cynicism of Larkin that Larkin seems to have retained. I'm thinking of High Windows, and I'm probably thinking of This Be the Verse, and I won't read them aloud. Although Betjeman read This Be the Verse aloud on BBC television towards the end of his life, famously and exceptionally well, despite his onsetting Parkinson's at the time. I find the cynicism, because life makes you cynical. Office life makes you cynical, and I think I can see that in Larkin as I can see it in my own pitiful existence, so to speak.
I think Larkin just had that...
The toad work,
yeah. He had that honesty, that kind of unflinching gaze, and he didn't ever want to kind of make life more gentle or easier than it actually is. You know, he looked at dementia, he looked at illness, he looked at, you know, encroaching death, and didn't want to look away, didn't want to soften it.
That's absolutely right. I mean, there's the descriptions of the people on the platform in the Whitsun weddings, I think, on the one hand, it reminds you of a Betjeman commentary, television commentary. I'm thinking particularly if you look at Thank God It's Sunday, the second part, where I think the action takes place in Southend, describing people and in sort of imposing an almost Johnny Morris animal magic, a voice on and a view onto those people. Betjeman's very kind about it, I think, although I dare say there were complaints occasionally. But in Larkin, the fathers have broad belts and seamy foreheads. The mothers are loud and fat, and the uncle shouts smut. And they probably all were.
Yeah.
One must be very careful not to make generalisations. I mean, because it's in that poem, it doesn't necessarily mean that Larkin thought all such people were like that. Like uncles always shouted smut and all the rest of it. But nevertheless, that there is a grittier realism in the Whitsun weddings, I think. Despite that, Larkin's chum, Kingsley Amis, found the horrible dig in the ribs prevalent in Betjeman. He was thinking of Croydon and a house like that, your Uncle Dick was born, et cetera, et cetera. But ends with the fact that Uncle Dick is dead. Betjeman, of course, wraps it up in almost sing-songy rhyme schemes, many of which were derived from his Victorian forebears.
Yeah.
And so you do get a dig in the ribs, but it can also pass you by if you're not looking for it.
And that's one of the big differences, I think, between Larkin and Betjeman's poetry is that they do use the Victorian formal structures and the quatrains and the rhyming. But Larkin said that he wanted people to see his poetry written down. And he did record his poems and he did read them aloud occasionally, publicly, but I know he said that he thought it was better to see the poem on the page, and that was what was key to him. And so the rhyming works in Larkin on the page. You don't hear, he doesn't do a lot of kind of rhyming couplets and things like that unless it's for a deliberate effect, like in Toads, for example.
Yeah.
But in a lot of his poems that do rhyme, like Essential Beauty, you only see that rhyme on the page, and that's when the kind of complexity of the structure really unfolds.
Whereas, tremendous skill, like Browning's My Last Duchess, where you only see that on the page as well. Grief, extraordinary, really, to achieve that.
Yeah, and I mean, and that's the same in Shakespeare and Keats, you know, the rhyming is there. When you see Shakespeare perform something like Romeo and Juliet, you don't always hear the rhymes. They're not always foregrounded, but then the writers have confined themselves into that very tight structure that they have to follow. But particularly with Larkin, his rhyming patterns are so complex and they add a whole extra layer to the poems, whereas Betjeman's, like you say, can often come across as just funny, because we associate rhyme in English language with humour a lot of the time.
Yes. And Betjeman could be genuinely very funny. And there are some poems that are heartbreaking in Betjeman, but what I think one has to go looking, whereas I'm fiddling with my copy of The Whitsun Weddings and it's the page, believe it or not, has fallen open on Home Is So Sad.
Yeah.
And I totally take your point about the look of the words on the page. And it's the last line, isn't it? The music in the piano stool, that vase.
Yeah.
That vase, a two-word sentence, and yet so much emotion conveyed. And you get that, I think, mainly because you can see it on the page.
Yeah. And just that very simple break in the middle that gives you the word theft all on its own. Because it's not a metaphorical theft of emptiness and that whole relationship between the person and the home and you know the lived in experience in the home. I love this poem, a joyous shot at how things ought to be. Not a line that people kind of really think of when they think of Larkin, you know, that there are lots of joyous shots in Larkin. There's lots of attempts at finding happiness and joy and looking for it. He doesn't just look at the bleak and the depressing at all.
No. And there's a lot more bleak and depressing in Betjeman, I think, than he's given credit for. And ironically, one of the earliest poems is one of the best in that regard, and it is Death in Leamington, which Larkin said brought a new kind of poetry into being, as in people in terms of place. Which I think also had an influence on Larkin back again, as it were. But you get that opening line in, and I can't read it as well as Samuel West, I'm afraid. And it is a sing-song kind of rhythm, but because of the subject matter of this opening, you get that dig in the ribs almost, as it were, immediately. She died in the upstairs bedroom by the light of the evening star that shone through the plate glass window from over Leamington Spa. And I think that conjures an image very, very clearly of laying in a bedroom with high windows, looking out at a particular skyline in a particular part of the country. And yet there's an amen at the end where the nurse has come in. She moved the table of bottles away from the bed to the wall and, tiptoeing gently over the stairs, turned down the gas in the hall, which is an old-fashioned mark of respect for the dead. And, of course, that is, and Amos picked this up too, that is one of the things about Betjeman that a lot of it discusses in the midst of life, we are in death.
Yeah.
Huge number of the poems, when you do look beyond the rhyme scheme, is about that, the quick and the dead kind of idea. And I think that is allied to his wrangles with belief and unbelief, as he refers to, alluding back to the great Victorian debate that tormented many a mind in the 19th century.
Betjeman's interesting architecture, as we were saying earlier about his concern about the way that the developers are changing our landscape. But there is an interest in architecture in terms of just preserving the kind of safety net of our heritage, you know, and the physicality of what's around us.
Yes.
And his campaign to preserve St. Pancras Station, you know, and his... I was reading your article the other day about the Euston Arch, and I think that is so sort of symbolic to me of Betjeman, you know, imagining what that station would have looked like now. Because when you go past Euston Station now, it's just pretty horrible, really, isn't it?
It is.
And I think, I assume maybe one day they might do something with it, like they tidied up, eventually they tidied up King's Cross and St. Pancras, and there was an older kind of attachment, wasn't there, to King's Cross that they've
there
now
was,
taken
the
away?
The 70s attachment.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's interesting that. I mean, firstly, I think that is probably one of the reasons why church going really jumped out for Betjeman, because it was thinking about and philosophising about what's going to happen to all of these fine buildings that have been part of the soul for so long as the 20th century went on. But also there's something in there about shifting tides and the ebb and flow of human consciousness, because I think we change over time. It's interesting. I've got a silly Twitter feed going on at the moment. It's not a thread. It's a daily thing I do. And it's a picture of a train. And I started it for my own sanity when lockdown began. And I didn't think I'd still be doing it come November when we're talking nearly November. And I put up a picture of a train at London Bridge in the later 70s, I think it was. And I referred to Betjeman and how he would have liked it. And somebody quoted from London's Historic Railway Stations back at me, which is a book from 72, I think, where he'd gone on about what a sort of unfriendly station it is, how unpleasant it was at that time for the passenger. And I thought about this, and undoubtedly that was right, but I'm absolutely certain that now he would be lamenting the loss of the old London Bridge and probably likening it to a Whistler engraving or something like he did Cleveland Pier, because what we now have in its place is so alien, is as alien, I think, to the Euston of the 1960s was, you know, that unfriendly place with not enough seats. Have contempt for passengers and all those phrases he linked together when talking about the new Euston, as it was once lauded. I think he would have changed his mind about some places, possibly even 1930s villas, which he didn't like at all, because of what has come since.
What did he not like about 1930s villas then?
I think they were the product of developers for him, and probably not as august and honest as some architecture in his mind. But then he did change his mind over time. I'm pretty convinced he wouldn't have liked the Shard, for example.
Yeah.
He may, however, have cast a slightly less jaundiced eye over the Barbican Centre. Maybe. It's quite a big ask, but then we have to remember that he left us in 1984.
Yeah.
And it's now 2020. And there is a chance that, you know, everything looks up better as it ages and as our consciousnesses become more used to seeing it.
That's right. That's right. I mean, I think the 1970s now has, you know, a kind of aesthetic that's very popular today, and people like the kind of the bright colours, you know, the kind of bold patterns, and those mixed with those kind of quite sleek lines of 1970s furniture. But people look at back at the 1980s as ugly now. You know, the 80s have yet to be rehabilitated,
and that will come, I'm sure.
Yeah, it will.
Not for me, but for many people, I'm certain, yes.
Yeah, and we are kind of cyclical beings, aren't we, and our tastes change according to maybe what we associate with those particular places. I know when I was an English teacher and I used to teach sort of study of accents, and there was a lot of research into why we find certain accents a little bit, you know, why we associate certain things with certain accents, and there was no... Yes. It was felt there wasn't a coincidence that there were more negative reactions to a Birmingham accent or a Liverpool accent, because it was possibly associated with the cities, you know, and the, you know, perhaps less aesthetically pleasing places, you know, and industrial places, and places of quite sort of working class and not associated with the upper echelons of society. Because if you play those different accents to non-British people, you know, like Americans, they don't have negative associations with a Brummie accent or a Geordie accent at all, you know, they don't hear the same differences because they don't have the same associations. And I'm sure taste is very much bound up with where you come from and you know, where you see yourself. With Betjeman, he wouldn't have ever wanted to live in those kind of 1930s villas, was it? He was aspiring to more than that.
That's right. Hence his contempt for the great block in Sheffield that he visited in the 50s. And whenever he talked about tower blocks, he talked about your children being like ants down at the bottom, and you know, and I can completely see where he's coming from on that. And you know, a lot of people do actually want the suburbia that he didn't really like, because you have your own little plot of land and what have you. And I think meeting a person living in a tower block and hearing them talk about how much better their conditions were at that time. And regardless of how tower blocks came to be later on, of course, when, you know, hotbeds of crime and all the rest of it, that was a different sociological set of circumstances. Aesthetically, I agree. He was aspiring to something else and so found it difficult to conceive that somebody might be delighted with their 30s villa or modern flat with all mod cons. And I think that's why there's a bit of ambiguity in Metroland. There's a lot of happy, satisfied people in Metroland the further he goes out, and yet he ends with grass triumphing, being rather glad about that. But then the people who live in Metroland arguably didn't want to live on top of where they worked, and so they had their own bit of countryside. They were allowed to have their own bit of countryside, as it were, even though it gobbled up fields that were once bright with buttercups, as he says. Yeah. But then it's the old adage of there being two sides to every story, I suppose.
Yeah, and I mean, people felt the railway lines, you know, damaged the environment when they were first built, and yet they were, you know, what he celebrated, I suppose, you know, in the huge stations like St Pancras. They were a huge part of like urban development. So it's a very complex.
It is.
Topic,
and there's never an easy answer. I think there are arguments that the motorways are a scar across the landscape.
Yeah.
But when railways were first conceived, and we're seeing that now, of course, in another context, they were considered scars across the landscape. And that's why we ended up with so many twisting, winding railway lines, because so many people, landowners, admittedly, back then, objected to the railway lines cutting across their land.
Yeah.
And yet, within a few years, within a comparatively short space of time, they did become part of the landscape, and Betjeman always viewed railway lines as part of the landscape, which is why it hurt so much when Beeching came along in the 60s, recommending that they be pulled up, or yeah. so many of them be pulled up, because they had become part of the landscape, and therefore back to that idea again of being part of one's soul, one's
yeah,
makeup.
Yeah. I know in modern kind of parlance, we talk about the psychogeography, don't we? And I think Betjeman was like an early proponent of that, if you like,
yeah.
exploring our kind of psychological links to our environment around us. And I think it's really interesting how he talks about architecture and how he brings architecture out. Because it's a bit of a hidden science to a lot of people, I think, and quite difficult and quite complex and very specialist. And yet it's something that affects our everyday life all the time. You know, when I was at school, I went to a very traditional all-girls grammar school with a very traditional head teacher. When I was in the first year, when I was 11, our head teacher, Miss Hammersley, would timetable herself for each form to do a lesson of architecture a week with us. This was in the early 80s. And so we would have an hour a week with Miss Hammersley learning about, you know, Gothic arches and things like that. And it, you know, obviously today school timetables are so completely wretchedly squeezed of any like imaginative, you know, creativity. I think it's really interesting that she saw architecture as something really important for the girls to know about, and not something that should be obscure or specialist. And it was a way of framing the world, you know, and understanding history and society and economics and religion. And it brought all those things together.
Exactly how Betjeman would view it. I mean, I learned something about architecture from Betjeman.
Yeah.
Because there is sort of learning, a lot of thought and learning, but behind all of Betjeman's writing on architecture, and architectural terms do come into the poems.
Yeah.
Faience adornments in Devonshire Street, W1.
I love that in Devonshire Street, West 1, because it just mystifies me that I've no idea what they are. I know I could Google it, but I quite like the fact I don't actually know what it is. And I love Betjeman's embracing of architectural language. It enriches the poetry. And he had this huge vocabulary of architecture that he could draw on.
And therefore, probably, to slip back to church going, cleaned or restored, someone would know, I don't. Betjeman probably would have done.
Yeah.
And he probably would have known if it was J.P. St. Albin, his favourite Victorian church restorer, Bete Noir. He always put restorer in double inverted commas in his writings. He probably would, but absolutely framing the soul, framing our lives, being creative, but within fairly strict boundaries as well, is something that I think you can pick up from architecture. I think it's tremendously important, and arguably some of his best work is in that field. But what I like about Betjeman is that he equates, it's usually not so much in the Archie Rev days in the 30s as he talked about that organ at the time and later on, but later it becomes very much a marriage between set and setting, people and place, as Larkin quite rightly said. But it's not only a town, it's a particular kind of building sometimes.
Yeah, and that's Betjeman's sort of unique eye, isn't it, that he sees the world in that way. And that's very different from Larkin. I don't know. Some people talk about Larkin's librarianship bringing a sense of order in the world, you know, that his photography as well as his writing shared the same skills that he brought to being a librarian, and that he wanted to kind of record and categorise the world around him in some way, if that makes sense, or to document.
I think he was documenting change, wasn't he? Just as much as Betjeman was, but in a different sort of sense. Yeah, Larkin was certainly marking time, aware of his own mortality, and aware of a world changing around him and what that might mean. As he waited to be led down Cemetery Road, or for the ambulance to turn up in his street.
Yeah.
For example, another very affecting poem, of course, which Betjeman quotes at him in the monitor program.
Yeah.
That's another thing. I mean, Bevis Hillier, who wrote the masterly three-volume biography of Betjeman, did comment, I think, something along the lines of, if you wanted to know what it was like to live in the 20th century, you should read Betjeman's poems. Well, I think that equally holds for Larkin, for the latter half.
Mm, mm.
Anyway, you can see the world changing. I think the picture of a painted in a girl in winter, for example, is a very different world to the one he paints in High Windows.
Yeah, reading A Girl in Winter, I felt I really learned something about World War II, really, and the lived experience at that time, and to be a young person.
I felt a dig in the ribs at the end myself, as Amos had with Betjeman, actually. Yes, I thought it was a very, very affecting novel indeed, and it did lead me to wish he'd written more.
Yeah, just even the descriptions of walking through the town in the blackout at night, and how you had to find your way in the pitch black. It's just something that's unthinkable now.
It is.
That we would ever get to that point. Even if we were ever in another sort of war, we would never turn off all the lights in that way. I couldn't imagine it.
A metaphorical and literal darkness.
Yeah. And I think that's what puts Betjeman and Larkin in a very different category from other contemporary writers like Ted Hughes. Or writers contemporary to them anyway, because, I mean, I quite like Ted Hughes' poetry and Sylvia Plath, for example, but you don't feel that they're looking around the world in the way that writers like Betjeman and Larkin were doing.
No, I agree. I agree. And Betjeman did some very good work during the war. I mean, he was even considered to be a threat by the IRA, as in, you know, in Ireland, he was considered at one time to be a spy. And then, as the story goes, somebody read his poetry and thought, well, actually, this man writes so beautifully, he can't possibly be a threat to anyone. But a lot of what Betjeman did in the war, I think, was about pointing out what was still here and what we need to remember to enjoy.
Yeah. What did Betjeman do through the war?
He worked for the Ministry of Information for a bit, but then he was sent across as a sort of cultural attaché to Dublin, because Ireland at the time wasn't quite sure which side it was on, I think. So it was a sort of charm offensive more,
right?
Really.
Yeah.
Important work, and work that would use all of his skills as an author, but as a people person, if you like.
Yeah, yeah.
Which he absolutely was. I think the early snobbery really did fall away when he was presented with somebody. And that, you know, very, very good. Despite Larkin's teasing comment about how he sort of took over the monitor program a bit, a lot of what Betjeman is actually saying in that program is Larkin's own verse. One wishes that the sequence where they were both sitting in Larkin's room talking had been longer, I think. Then you probably would have got more Larkin coming out, because I think Betjeman had the capability of doing that. He was probably a worker very, very interested in the telly, as he called it, and how it worked and the technical side of things. He was probably very aware that there was a job that had to be done and he needed to make sure it was done to fill out the 30 minutes or whatever. But he knew how to engage with people, I think.
Yeah, and that's the opposite of Larkin. Larkin didn't even own a television at that point. He had to go to a friend's house to watch it being broadcast.
Very telling comment near the end, isn't there, where Betjeman says, "Well, I read some of your work to some local people, and it brought tears to their eyes. Who is this man? We'd love to meet him." And Larkin simply said, "Oh, another evening gone," which I laughed out loud at. But it's very Larkin.
Although within his circle of friends and his work colleagues, he was actually quite gregarious, wasn't he? And he did like to go out and. I was reading a diary and a letter earlier on today. I'm not sure when it was. I was looking for something about Halloween or All Hallows weekend. But he said, "I've not been going out to the bar this week. It saved money and better for my health," because obviously he did like a drink and he did like to go to meet people and see people. Mm. But he didn't like to sort of do those public engagements like Betjeman. And he did, you know, he had a hearing loss and he was always very self-conscious of his appearance. I mean, in that Monitor documentary, he's only in his mid-40s, isn't he?
Yes. And yet he looks so much older.
He looks so much older. I mean, I don't know whether that's me, you know, I was looking at the 1960s and the kind of clothing and the dress and you think, oh, maybe put him in jeans and T-shirt and he might have looked a bit younger. But he was always very self-conscious about his kind of, how he had to look and the thick glasses that he had to wear, his thick glasses. Whereas Betjeman really exploited his slightly peculiar looks, didn't he? I think he played up to that.
He did.
That was part of his personality.
He did. He kind of had that sort of fogey-ish image very early on. And, of course, Betjeman loved to get a reaction from an audience.
Yeah.
There were plenty of sound clips of him speaking at sort of live, as it were, getting big laughs, and that was grist to the mill.
Yeah.
Betjeman was a performer, I think, at heart, and possibly even first and foremost, hence his great success with television.
Yeah.
Including the televised version of Summoned by Bells. Although he's clearly getting very old. And, you know, the Parkinson's is starting to kick in a little bit more, I think, by 1976. But it's still a very engaging way of putting that poem across, which I think is arguably his greatest poem.
But yeah. It's
personal. And we lose that rhyme too.
Yeah.
Because it's in blank.
Blank verse, yeah.
Betjeman, play to the crowd sounds unkind, and I don't mean it to be, but he liked to know how he was doing. How am I doing? And if you're in front of lots of real people, you'll find out pretty quickly how you're doing.
I know Jonathan Smith suggested that one of the reasons why he liked these public engagements so much was it got him out of his difficult domestic life sometimes, and he could leave that behind.
I think that's, you know, put on the garb of the character he wanted to be evening or whatever. Yeah, I do agree with that.
Yeah, and Larkin didn't want to do that. He didn't want to engage in that. And he has, you know, Larkin said, I didn't want to go around pretending to be me. Thanks so much to Greg for coming along. And all the links to the many films, documentaries and books that we've discussed will be available on the Philip Larkin Society website, as well as the Anchor podcast website. And I'll also make sure there's details there of Greg's two books that he wrote about John Betjeman. A quick shout out to some of our new Twitter followers at the Tiny and All That Air Twitter account: Matthew Wyatt, S.A. Rayners, 70s Ghost Child, and Will MacDonald. And thank you to all our followers, as always. I'm also very pleased that Dr. Alex Howard, who's just published a new book about Larkin called Larkin's Travelling Spirit, is now following us. And I'm sure we will be featuring Alex in a future podcast. I also want to say hello to Dr. Yuwendi Okalai at Leicester University, who is currently doing some work on Rhoda Bennett, the university librarian who worked with Larkin at Leicester. And a shout out to The Whole Scribbler, which is Hull University's creative writing journal, and I'm doing some writing with them at the moment, which is fantastic. So thank you everyone. If you'd like to support this podcast, then please consider becoming a member of the Society at the website, which is £25 a year, but it gets you access to member-only events and the Society Journal and all kinds of fabulous stuff. You can also support the podcast by leaving 5-star reviews for us, retweeting, and just generally inviting fellow Larkin fans to listen in. This podcast was produced by Simon Galloway, and the music was kindly provided by the Mechanicals Band. This year, I'm featuring a different track from the Mechanicals Band new CD that's available from Bandcamp called The Righteous Jazz. And today I will leave you with their setting of a poem that I discussed with Greg earlier, This Be the Verse. They fuck you up, your mum and dad. They may not mean to, but they do. They fill you with
the faults they had, and add some extra just for you. But they were fucked up in their turn by fools in old style hats and coats, who half the time were soppy stern and half at one another's throat. Hands on misery to man, it deepens like a coastal shelf. Get out as early as you can and don't have any kids yourself. Man, hands on misery to man, it deepens like a coastal shelf. Get out as early as you can and don't have any kids yourself. Oh, yourself.